Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your moderator for this afternoon's session, Alan Riley.
Right. Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking energy union and energy disunion, and we've got a fantastic panel to discuss all of these issues. Right. So nearest to me, I've got Mr. Daniel Mitov, the Foreign Minister of the Slovak Republic. Next to him, we've got Mr. So did I say Slovak? I said
like
Bulgarian. See, this is trouble. I'm having a terrible day. So mixing up my republics. It's a very bad British habit. But no, from the Bulgarian Republic. We have then got Mr. Sekovic, who is, of course, the Vice President for Energy Union. And you can see his shoulders sagging with the burden of his office to deliver Energy Union. Then next to him, we've got Dr. Faith Bittol, who is actually the chief economist, the International Energy Agency, and is going to give us a more global perspective. And finally, we've got the former Czech Prime Minister, the man who had to handle just the 2009 gas crisis himself, Mr. Topolánek. So we've got a good, great panel for you, and we're going to discuss energy union. Now, I'm going to start by throwing a few questions at these gentlemen, and then once we've done that, what we're going to do is we're going to open it to the floor. And the idea is for most of this, it's debate. It's Q&A, and we're going to hopefully get lots of good questions. I spot some energy specialists in the audience, some CEOs of energy companies, some board members, some energy analysts, some spiky researchers, some spiky ambassadors. So what I'm hoping is that we'll get some good questions as we go along. But what I'd like to start with, if at all possible, is turning to the panel now. And I'd actually like to start, if possible, with Dr. Birol and look at a global perspective. I mean, we're talking in Europe. There's terrible, terrible tendency of the Europeans, and this I even include the British, is that we have this tendency to look navel-gazing inward, and not notice what's going on in the rest of the planet. And of course, there are lots of interesting things happening globally. Daniel Jurgen refers to the shale gale, the shale revolution in the United States, spreading elsewhere. We've got developments in solar technology, which suggest that solar may become the defining transformative renewable. And I was wondering, perhaps first of all, is what advice you might give the Europeans. Is there a danger that we're kind of reinventing the wheel, looking at old models of energy development when we should be looking more global? And will US shale gas save us? Will we all be using solar? What do you think advice you would give to Mr. Sekovic and his colleagues and the European member states to look out for from the global energy markets and what's going to happen in the next few years? So perhaps over to Dr. Birol to start with.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon to all of you. It's, of course, a very broad question. But first of all, let me tell you that Europe is not an energy island. What is happening in the rest of the world will affect Europe, European energy markets, and what happens in Europe affects the global markets less than otherwise it would be. It means global markets affect Europe more than Europe affects the global markets in general. This is number one. Number two, whether shale will save the world, shale oil and gas, I think it will save the United States rather than the world. But of course, the shale revolution in the United States has a lot of positive implication for the markets. In terms of oil, United States will import less oil. But a common mistake is to believe that with the shale oil production in the United States, some of us believe that U.S. will be a very important exporter or replacing Middle East. This is completely wrong, but completely wrong. U.S. oil production growth is only, if at all, is meeting the U.S. domestic oil consumption. United States will never be a major oil exporter. Middle East is and will remain the major exporting region of the world. And what happens in the Middle East today, from a geopolitical point of view, is for me is a major worry for many years to come from an energy security point of view. However, Europe makes some important steps, which are also very important, especially on the hidden fuel, not oil, not gas, and others, which is the energy efficiency. Mm-hmm. Europe is making major efforts, and now the results are coming. Mm-hmm. Let me give you one example. In Europe, in the last 10 years, number of household appliances we have, television sets, wash machines, refrigerators, and so on a household basis, it increased almost 3 times, number of them. We had the richer the Europeans become, they bought a second and third refrigerator. But electricity consumption in households did not increase, it stayed the same. It is mainly as a result of the policies to put the efficiency at the top of the agenda, namely for refrigerators, standards and norms and others. So Europe is definitely a major player there. Now, one final thing and I will finish it here. For me, what I see in Europe is the main, what is the main challenge? Many challenges, but one of them very crucial, and I think the energy union is, the colleagues in Brussels are pushing forward is a very important answer to that, which is the following. When you look at the European electricity generation today, almost 30% comes from coal, mm-hmm. and another 30% comes from nuclear power. Okay, almost two of them together make 60%. And in Europe in general, I don't say everywhere, but in general, we want to turn our shoulder to both of them. And governments may be right or wrong, I don't want to say anything on that, but it is very important, the 60%, what are we going to replace with? With which fuels? And what are the economic and geopolitical concerns of this replacement? What is our strategy? For me, this is the major issue. And if you put this 60%, we say no to nuclear in many countries, we say no to coal in many countries. So how are we going to replace them in a world which is, in my view, from a geopolitical perspective, becoming less and less safe? And when you look at all the major energy producers today in Middle East and elsewhere, the stability is not the color which is mostly seen in those countries. So for me, energy security in Europe is a very important subject, given the general perspective of the world. And for Europe, it is especially important because of the, our policies vis-a-vis nuclear and vis-a-vis coal, without judging them, they are right or wrong, but what are we going to replace them with and what are their consequences, a major topic for me.
Thank you very much. That's a very comprehensive and kind of global view. Now, I suppose turning more to Europe, I perhaps should ask Mr. Sekovic, you know, how easily are we going to be able to deliver the energy union? It seems to me that it is a, in many ways you look at it, it is an entirely broad brush document which was initially produced. We're going to try to save member states with improving their supply security, undertaking energy transformation, and maintain cost competitiveness all at the same time. This is why I was referring to the sagging burden on your shoulders. This is quite a lot to deal with. What's the route map? How do we get from where we are to where we want to get to?
No, thank you very much for that question. And I think it's very important that we move in all the dimensions at the same time. Why? Because all the dimensions caused that or created the political momentum to actually have energy union. Because I'm sure that I hear see many of my colleagues who are dealing or with energy or with European affairs. If I would tell them 3 years ago that we would be talking about energy union, they would not believe me, because at that time the energy was really very much seen as something which is very national, which is very specific, which each country wants to keep for herself. But I think that exactly the issues you refer to, how to integrate renewables, energy security, Mr. Birol was referring to, geopolitical situation in Eastern Ukraine, in the Middle East, shale gas revolution, which suddenly puts really very high on the agenda the energy price and overall competitivity of Europe. All these being the factors which made it very clear for the European leadership that if you want to keep your competitivity, if you want to keep preserve your social model, you have to deal with the way how you manage the energy. And we want to do it in our European way. So we want to have a deep economic transition, but at the same time, very important energy transition transformation as well. So Mr. Birol was putting very, very right question. And what is, of course, a major dilemma for the European Commission is what should be the best recipe to combine the sovereign right of every member state to decide their own energy mix, and at the same time to respect the European umbrella, meaning European legislation, meaning all our climate action goals to which we agreed to collectively. So I can answer to Mr. Birol that by 2030 we for sure will reduce the CO2 emission, I believe, by more than 40%. I believe that we will have more than 27% of productions coming from renewables. And I believe that we would also exceed our targets in energy efficiency. Why? Because what I see is going on in Western Europe, and I believe that very soon it will be also here in Central and Eastern Europe, this is, I would say, that enormous business movement introducing renewables, energy efficiency technologies into the operation. It's coming, it's here, the technologies which are already available are really fantastic, and we just need to create appropriate regulatory environment and, of course, adequate financial support for making sure that our markets are interconnected to benefit from this energy transition. I would probably be too optimistic, but I dare to say that Europe can even profit from the fact that we would be prime mover in this situation, because each country have a little bit different view on how you deal with the energy. But if you look at the air pollution in China, for example, I can tell you that one of the major interests for the clean tech technology of European origin is coming from China, from India, because they want to increase the energy consumption and they're looking how to do it in a cleaner way. If you look at energy efficiency of our companies, of course we have higher prices, but we are twice as energy efficient in our industry as American companies, and that's, I believe, also advantage for the future. So I believe that we would need to find a way how to combine the national interest with the European one. I think it's the same thing, I would say, for every aspect of the European relations which we deal with. Of course, here it's much more present. It's much more linked with specificity and national sovereignty. But I think we finally got it that we have to move on this one together.
Right. Thank you very much. Very concise and also, I think, hopeful description. Now I'd like to move on to Prime Minister Topolnek. And we had a discussion beforehand about the range of subjects we might want to look at. And one of them, which I think has come up very topical, is the extension of Nord Stream. Because it seems to me some degree is that if you've got Western energy companies are making memorandum of understanding with Gazprom, this surely cuts across the hopefulness of energy union. How does that fit with solidarity amongst member states? Perhaps over to you, Prime Minister.
Good question. Thank you very much. I think it is a shot to our leg. We discuss about energy union. We discuss about internal energy market. We discuss about interconnectivity and about new goals in this field. And at the same time, we can see the one of the biggest problem of European Union. Only domestic and national interests, corporation interests, big guys in European Union try to push through only our interests, and it is one of the biggest obstacles of the realization of this brilliant idea, brilliant long-term objective in energy field. But on the other hand, everybody try to reduce this the discussion about energy and energy security only to dependence on Russia, gas and oil, and lack of interconnectors and so on. But the problem of energy security is much more complicated. It is question of security of supply after the renewable revolution in the European Union. I am not fan of this new religion. I am not believer of this ideology. I have a big problem with German Energiewende plan to stop nuclear, to reduce and stop lignite, to reduce gas and to realize domestic consumption only through renewable sources. It is one of the biggest problems. It is comparable problem with Russia assertive policy in gas, yes. For me. I think what's going on Nord Stream, I remember in January 2009, then Russia stopped supply via Ukraine in that time, and the crisis brought big troubles for Slovakia, for Balkan countries, Bulgaria. Stanishev and Fico called me every half hour, what's new, what's up, how we will solve it. And I was in that time as president of European Council responsible to bring some solution. And I traveled to Kyiv and to Moscow and repeatedly to Kyiv, and I achieved some agreement, basic agreement. The situation was for the short term resolved. But what was the main reason of this crisis? When we can speculate about some desire or effort of Russia administration to change political scene in Ukraine, it was some middle term goal. But the main reason was very strong resistance in that time in Sweden, Poland, Baltic countries against Nord Stream. Mm-hmm. After this crisis, the first and second line was immediately built up. Now the situation is very similar. We are discussing about how to keep a transition line via Ukraine, how to help to Ukraine to overcome this crisis and so on, the war. And at the same time, we're discussing about some potential new project, how to strengthen energy security, what's going on interconnectivity. We discuss about E-String and Tesla and Nabucco West. At the same time, announcement from before yesterday between E.ON and Gazprom and Shell and OMV is, I think, big frustration for everybody. Because when you will calculate the current volume going from Russia to European Union, it is about 120 BCM. It is officially 140, but 20 BCM is realized through subsidiaries in the spot European market, and we shouldn't calculate as a Russia supply. And now the Nord Stream has a capacity about 55 BCM, Yamal is 30, and Ukraine transit is to 240 additional volume with big reserve. It's twice more than it is necessary. 10 in Nord Stream, 30 in Yamal, and Russia will stop and bypass Ukrainian transit without any problems. But European Union will be without any reserves, any potential additional volume of gas. And I think it is long-term policy of Russia administration. We shouldn't be surprised. Everybody who have read energy strategy of Russia from 2003 upgraded 2009 must know that it is long-term goal how to bypass Ukraine, how to control all pipelines going from Russia with gas and oil to European Union, how to diversify risk with a supply to Southeast Asia, how to control Central Asian sources of oil. And it's so visible that we shouldn't be surprised. I'm not surprised.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know. I think we're not surprised. I was originally asked in the Russian embassy in London a few years ago about Nord Stream. And I said, what do you think about building Nord Stream to the UK? I said, well, you can build an expensive pipeline with an expensive gas into the most liberalized competitive market in Europe. And you can lose your shirt, but you're more than welcome to actually build it if you wish. And I think one of the issues, I think what you have to look at with Nord Stream is exactly how they can build all this additional capacity, which of course will cost them a lot of money, and operate in an increasingly competitive, not just the British market, but the Northwest European market and increasingly across the continent. So I think the real question is about building expensive new pipelines. And if European consumers won't pay for them, and there is more competition from amortized pipelines and already paid for LNG terminals, how easy is it going to be for Gazprom to make these work economically? They may work geostrategically to isolate Ukraine, and there are even questions about how easy that is to do. But one of the real questions is commercially, how does this work? Also in a situation where Gazprom itself is in some financial trouble. So enough of me. Let me now turn to Mr. Mitov. And I think one of the questions which I think we can actually look at here is, and this is raised in terms of Bulgaria being a great example of supply security vulnerability. I mean, you have tremendous dependence on a single gas supplier. You've got potentially interconnectors around which could be built from different member states. High energy prices, which toppled the government. How do you see how Bulgaria itself can benefit from energy union?
Well, first, Alan, I would like to refer to the lapsus in the beginning and say the following.
Yeah.
I take it as a compliment because what we are actually trying to build is a unified yeah. European message, and that at a certain point, it should not matter who sits here, whether it's the Bulgarian or the Slovak. For yeah. a minister, we should deliver one and the same message. Mm-hmm. Because what the Russians see in us in the European Union is an unsuccessful project. Mm-hmm. They believe we are unsuccessful in our second part, European, yes, but Union, no. And we have to realize that until we don't unify our strategy, and here the burden on the shoulders of Maroš Šefčovič is really high mm-hmm. in order to build up a strategy which is in accordance with the interests of all of us and answers exactly this type of questions, how to reduce the vulnerability, how to diversify the sources of gas in a way that everyone feels secure and that we reach a point in which the European Union can rely on gas from both East and West being transferred from one side to another on a market-based price. Mm-hmm. So this is a highly difficult task, and of course we will be as helpful as possible in it, and we're trying to be with all the suggestions and proposals. And I won't be tired of repeating that the start of the energy security and diversification in Southeastern Europe starts from the Bulgarian-Greece interconnection, which is for years already blocked. And it is not blocked only because of us or our Greek colleagues. It is also because of interferences from outside. Mm-hmm. And you know exactly who I'm referring to. So basically, of course, Russian gas will flow into Europe. Of course it will continue to flow, and we want it and everyone wants it. But it needs to be under our conditions, not under the conditions of Russia. Because yesterday I hear Mr. Putin saying no one can talk to us with ultimatums. Yes, but what we hear on the other side are ultimatums. It is in 2019 we're going to stop the transfer of gas through Ukraine. That's an ultimatum. We need to stop as a united Europe to call the bluffs every time they throw them on the table. Because talking about the stream, South Stream was supposed to go through Bulgaria, it didn't. Because we were bound to the European rules and regulations and we resisted it. Now there's Turkish Stream. So these streams, there was a very interesting comment on the internet the other day, some anonymous person said, well, these streams are already flinging around in the Black Sea like a garden hose. That's stream after stream out there, and we're calling the bluffs all the time. And all of a sudden, we're trying to accommodate to that by building up our own ideas and projects and competing with each other, which is actually destroying our unity. We are the client. We are the ones who are paying for the gas. And we have to determine where it will come into Europe. And if Ukrainian the Ukrainian environment is problematic for someone, we can actually work a way in which to deliver the gas into Europe. And I would slightly disagree here with Prime Minister Topolánek about the comparison between the two situations when Nord Stream was built and now there are other projects, because we are in a very different situation. Mm-hmm. At the time, Russia was seen as a partner or as a country we could work with in order to build common strategies and common common future. Now, after the annexation of Crimea, after the interferences and the aggression in Ukraine, the situation is completely different, and we need to realize that. We need to start talking in a very different voice. The interconnectivity on the Balkans is the key. That's our thinking is Bulgaria, Greece, Bulgaria, Serbia, Bulgaria, Romania, in order to be able to deliver gas north and west.
Right, thank you very much, Ms. Smitov. Actually, this gives us a great opportunity now to move towards the vote. We've been talking about Russia as a gas supplier. Is it really reliable? And I think we're going to have a vote now. I think you've got the question up there. Is Russia a reliable supplier of gas to the European Union? It's very simple, yes or no. And use your Globsat app, go to the voting section and vote yes or no. Is Russia a reliable supplier of gas to the European Union? Please vote now. So that's okay. You've got about 15, 20 seconds to vote, and then the numbers should come up. Here come the results. Perhaps not entirely surprising, but it gives you a sense of where we are with Russia-EU gas relations and concerns that exist, I think, right across the continent these days, and it explains part of the reason for energy union. Now, what I'd like to move on to is our Q&A. We've got about an hour. The basic message is we want your name, we want your affiliation, keep your questions brief and to the point. There are brownie points for colorful quotes and a bit of imagination. Okay, back to the gentleman here in the middle.
Thank you very much for this intervention. My name is Jean-André Barbosa. I'm representing Arriva for Central Eastern Europe. I used to work in the European Commission, and in DG Energy, we were always talking about the magic triangle of energy, where you had competitiveness, security, and environment. After that, I noticed that actually each of these summits refers to different authorities in charge of it. If it is competitiveness, it is mainly the problem of the companies. If it is security, then it is the problem of the states. And if it is environment, it is now the problem mainly of the European Union. So we do not have the same centers of decision for all this. And depending on the years, the center of gravity of the energy policy is moving in this triangle.
Can you
and
be
my question
specific,
is,
you know?
Do question. You think that the energy union today is the correct center of gravity of this triangle?
Right, perhaps for the commissioner, is there?
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. And the truth is, I would say that it's even more complicated shape than the triangle, because when we've been looking at how we should put the comprehensive holistic approach to all the issues which are kind of linked with the energy, we very quickly realized that the number one priority for our leaders and the concerns of our citizens are very much linked with the energy security. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, one of the best recipe how to tackle the energy security is actually to complete the energy market, to remove administrative and technical barriers so energy could really flow freely among the EU. Then, of course, we have to work and respect all our obligations we made towards climate policy. So, of course, the issue of decarbonization. We had to use much more European technologies and moderate our demand and definitely increase our energy efficiency, and for that we need also scientific support. So we ended up with the five dimensions of the energy union. And then, of course, you have to work to deliver on all of them. So it was quite clearly that it's definitely not for one commissioner only. I mean, because you need to deal with trade, you need to deal with agriculture, you need to deal with transport, you need to deal with competition. So what I want to say is that actually we are now working together as a team of 14 commissioners who is delivering on the energy union, because it's very complex, and one issue is influencing the other. If we increase energy efficiency by 1%, we can import by 2.6% less of gas. So imagine if we increase energy efficiency by 5 or 10%. Here we are talking big numbers. So I think that it's really the right answer. But there is, of course, the huge challenge. And for me, the biggest challenge in this is how to change the mindset of our national decision makers, that not only when we are talking about the strategy, but when we proceed with the implementation, that they would think in more European terms, they would think in more regional approaches if it comes to how to manage, for example, the electricity market, and that they would respect that what is very important and what Mirek Topolánek was referring to, speaking with one voice. How to translate the political decision into the decisions which are also respected by our commercial companies. And that would be something which, of course, will not be easy, but I would say that for the first time we are trying to do it in a comprehensive manner, all of us together, but definitely it's not an easy task.
It's great. Prime Minister Topolánek, you think you had an observation?
I think it's an accurate and right question. All the time we declare some effort to find the center of this triangle. Reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, competitiveness, equal price, and energy security. What's the result of European policy now? We have twice bigger price of electricity than United States. We have maybe 2.5 bigger price of gas than United States. Competitiveness is going down totally. I am very active in investment, and I know it. What is Czech Republic, Slovak Republic, European companies able to export? Energy security is not better. We solve the first problem. We reduced CO2 emissions, but globally, the CO2 emissions are growing. Mm-hmm. It is only European issue, European homework. And what's the main reason? The spot market price of electricity in European Union is less than 32 euros. It's impossible to build up new conventional power plant. It's impossible now with this price to operate. There are many gas power plants finished operation, especially in Germany, Irsching and others. And what's the reason of this price? Because it's some diagram, merit order. The sources are used, what's going on, variable costs. And when we subsidized renewable sources, the first are using the solar and wind, then some subsidized some capacity payments and so similar, similar subsidies to production of electricity. And the price is going down, but the price for client is bigger and bigger, more than 100 euro. It's a big, big problem. And when we will solve this, when we will keep this climate policy with these allowances and many sanctions to conventional production, the gap will be bigger and bigger, and we will totally lose competitiveness of European production.
This is the problem for poor Mr. Šeković, the sagging burden on his shoulders. He's got to also fix the emissions trading scheme, amongst many other problems. Deal with Gazprom, emissions trading scheme, renewables, energy efficiency. It's a bit of a nightmare. let me just ask the next question. Gentleman over here, I think to my right. Just right, the gentleman at the front, and then perhaps we can take the gentleman at the back. We'll take the two questions together. Thanks.
Masaishi, just to pick up the points raised by IAEA Executive Director about nuclear. In my layman's assessment, less dependency on Russia plus being nice to climate change means more nuclear. Mm-hmm. Am I right? If I'm right,
sorry,
how can... less dependency on Russia, mm. plus being nice to climate change, mm. means nuclear power.
Well, that's the question.
Okay. That is a question. So how, if that is the case, how can European countries like Germany do it okay. in the near future?
And then perhaps to take the microphone to the gentleman in the white at the back as well. Great, excellent. A name and affiliation, please.
Yeah, hello, my name is Andrew Repman. I'm a journalist with EU Observer in Brussels. And I wanted to ask about this Nord Stream development. Firstly, to Commissioner Šefčovič, do you think that this is a threat to energy security for Eastern and Southeastern Europe? You'd be making the case against Turk Stream. Would you make a case against this development on similar grounds? And specifically also to Minister Mitov, I mean, because of the third energy package, because of European laws, you were made to suspend construction of South Stream, which was going to bring a lot of income to your country. How do you feel now that you have this development in the north? I mean, is there such a thing as energy solidarity in the EU?
Okay, perhaps Mr. Birol on your nuclear first, and then we'll talk
so
about
I know that there are different views in Europe about nuclear and the future of nuclear. I respect all of them. But there is one very serious situation, and I don't know how we don't realize it's an important trend. Not only today the share of nuclear in the European electricity generation is 30%, one-third. And there are two trends. One, as you rightly mentioned, not only Germany, but other countries like Belgium, as a deliberate policies, they are phasing out nuclear. This is one. But more importantly, the European nuclear fleet is old. And there will be many retirements very soon. And in most cases, if not all, they are not going to be replaced with the current policies with nuclear power. So as a result of that, the share of nuclear power in 20 years of time will go to 5%. So my question is, how are we going to compensate, replace this from 30% to 5% in a growing electricity market? With which fuels, and what are the implications of A, on economy, it means the prices, electricity prices, B, on energy security, and C, on CO2 emissions, climate change, as nuclear is a fuel, as my colleague just mentioned over there, is a no emission polluting fuel. So this is a key question. We cannot ignore too long this question. And as I said, there are two drivers, one, deliberate policies, and second, the aging of the nuclear fleet. Today, the average nuclear fleet in Europe is 32 years old. So coming to an end of their lifetime, the power plants. And for me, it's a very important question in front of us, and whether or not renewables, which are making very important inroads in Europe, will be able to meet that gap is an important issue.
Right, okay, thank you very much, Mr. Brock. Very comprehensive. Perhaps we can move to the issues to do with Nord Stream.
Yeah, I think that's a very correct question. So my thoughts here are, as I have to say, very preliminary, because I don't think that I have more information that you do on this issue. It was announced 2 days ago, and we are now studying the implications of this announcement. So really what I'm saying here is based on, I would say, preliminary thoughts I have on this issue. If you look at the big numbers, what is suggestion under the Nord Stream 3 and 4 is to increase capacity to this northern route by, I think, 55 billion of cubic meters. If you look at Ukrainian transit, altogether it's 140 billion cubic meters to Europe. I think capacity continues to Central and Eastern Europe in the volume of 100 BCM. And what we would get in the result if we do not have clear statement that the transit routes through Ukraine would be preserved. Actually, we would get lower capacity because we would lose 140 and we'll get 55. So we're actually losing something like 85 billion cubic meters of capacity. We are reducing the transit to Europe from three lines, Ukrainian, Yamal, and Nord Stream, to only two. And on top of it, we would face the total gas disbalance in Central Europe, because we would suddenly have to transform the countries who've been traditionally transit countries to the end-user countries. And we would have enormous congestions down the road because simply the structure is not prepared for it. So I would say, based upon this first observation, I would say that this is definitely on the project which is increasing the energy security of Europe if the transit through Ukraine is not preserved. And therefore, what I really think would be the reasonable things to do here, I think at first we really need to analyze how much gas do we need in Europe. Now we are, the last year I think we had 425 BCM consumption. We really have to measure how much we would need in 2030 with all our energy efficiency, renewables, but also gas playing, I think, increasingly more important role than a coal because of the CO2 factor. So we really need to factor this in place. And then I think we need to have the debate, hopefully, that would be my clear preference, based on commercial grounds. What is cost efficient? What is good for a big supplier, but also for us who are the big consumers? And I think that if we do this, we would also realize that currently the infrastructure for export of gas from Russia into Europe is used only for 57%. So I really like to understand a little bit the economics of all this. Of all these plans to actually, you know, going for this expensive infrastructure build-up where we have something here which is underused, which was working under the Cold War, to which I would say we are used to, which we can refurbish, renovate, put on new commercial grounds, interlink much better than before, and have, I would say, the agreement among big supplier and big consumer. If you allow me just one more sentence based on that opinion poll you just made. When I'm meeting Russians and Ukrainian partners in this trilateral setup, as we did for the winter package, I'm very often telling them, the guys, you have enormous responsibility for the image of gas in Europe. Because when I travel now across Europe and I talk a lot to the university students, when you mention the gas, immediately the second question is, you know, will we have enough gas? Will it be supplies? What about energy security? So it's kind of linked, you know, the gas is linked with the problem. Mm-hmm. It's not linked with a solution which it might be, because it's less CO2. The content of CO2 is smaller than in a coal. But for that, I think we need to work jointly, and therefore I definitely prefer the talks based on economic grounds, mutual advantages approach to make sure that Russia would be seen as a reliable supplier, Ukraine would be seen as a reliable transit country, and I think everybody knows that we are very reliable consumer, which is paying on time and paying a lot. So that would be my clear preference how to resolve this issue.
Ellen, right. May I just say two things, two dimensions to put the picture a bit.
I forgot it.
to put it in the context. One is the following. Maroš mentioned this, is right, that the European gas demand will increase. But more important than that, European gas imports will increase more than the European gas demand. Because European domestic gas production is in decline. Mm-hmm. So therefore, we should only look at the gas security issue, and the we should only look at the demand, but the imports, mm-hmm. which is a closer variable to look when we want to understand our needs. This is one, when we look at the gas discussion. The second one, European gas, when we discuss these issues, more than 90% of the discussion is on the pipelines. But the LNG markets are changing. And we will see not only from North America, but also from the Asia, there will be some new LNG coming in the picture from Australia, especially. And this will increase the markets, will make the markets much more fluid in terms of availability of LNG. I think these two points need to be also considered when we look at the Europe and gas discussion.
That's very interesting.
Can we promise to top up?
Very short remark to Fatih Birol and nuclear, only one sentence. There is only substitute to nuclear fission, it is nuclear fusion. It is only joke, but I hope it won't be joke in the future. What's going on gas? It's only approach. We will play the geopolitical pipeline policy game of Russia or not. I'm against to play this game. And we have to discuss, it is not lack of gas within the market. We have for 20 years reserves in Norway shelf. We have 200 BCM now in this time regasification capacity. Mm-hmm. We can increase the capacity of LNG, as Fatih Birol mentioned. We have 150 potentially BCM from Russia. And it is question of price and conditions, not to be dependent, but to allow Russia to supply to Europe, because the Chinese way is not some big winning for Russia. And when you have 50% of the budget in Russia, depending on gas and oil export, and the income to budget dropped to for 6-7%, yeah, I think it is a little bit more complicated situation to decide not to supply to Europe. Yeah. And the biggest reserves are, of course, in Caspian, Black Sea, Mediterranean, new sites in Cyprus and Israel, and Iraq and Iran. What's better, Russia or Iran? I don't know. But we have to prepare so clear situation, free access to every country, as Maroš Šefčovič planned or plans. And we have to build up infrastructure to allow this independence what's going on routes, because gas is enough. Yeah. It's as only problem of our unity in European Union.
As Winston
Nord Stream is going against.
As Winston Churchill said when setting up BP in 1912, it is variety, variety, and variety alone which provides the supply security. And that, I think, remains true. It was true in 1912, it's true in 2015. Now, Mr. Mitoff, you want any observations on
well, of course, there was a question directly posed, but yeah. I would just like to add and agree here with Prime Minister Topolánek that we should stop playing the geopolitical gas game of Russia. It was said in the beginning as well, we need to stop calling the bluffs, and as the customer, try to make the infrastructure which already exists from the Soviet times work for the European Union. That's what we need to do. The infrastructure is there, the possibilities are there, we are buying the gas, we have our conditions, we just need to work on the unity and the solidarity here. Because in the minute in which a bluff goes out, MOUs start flying around and we start commenting them. So we all know that there are billions of MOUs signed all over the world with no consequences. But we need to address every single one of them because they are sending the wrong signals. Mm. And here, another dimension of it. With the diversification, the South Gas Corridor, the Iraqi gas, the Iranian gas eventually in the future, the Azeri gas, those will pass through Turkey. And we need to find ways in order to assure that Turkey will be a reliable transit country. Mm-hmm. We need to find the modality in order not to fall within another dependence. But addressing here the the LNG terminals, that's clear, we mentioned it already, but to address the South Stream question, yes, we did everything in order to comply to the European rules. And we expect from everyone else to do the same. And when it comes to solidarity, we need to sit down and very seriously talk about our own strategy, our own ways, build them, and talk in one voice. Because how am I going to explain to the Bulgarian people why South Stream was not possible? And Turkish Stream will be possible through Greece, for example. It's another question that Greece and Russia signed an MOU about Turkish Stream without Turkey. So there's how this is even within the sane logic of everything. Mm-hmm. So these things, we need to very carefully assess them. Yes, South Stream was potentially something that Bulgaria will have been benefited from. Even if you look at the contract itself, it's quite difficult to assess when exactly mm-hmm. benefits for Bulgaria would have come. But the thing that I need to say here, and it needs to be heard loud, is South Stream is not formally cancelled. Mm-hmm. Put this into your notebooks, because this is another part of the game. South Stream, the intergovernmental agreement has not been denounced. The company still exists. We are formally asking the Russian side, are you actually cancelling South Stream as it was announced by President Putin from Ankara? There's no answer. There's no answer. All the options are open.
I'm going to take some more questions. I'm going to go on to the next session. Well, I think that's very interesting. This issue of the Russians keeping their option opens is very interesting. I ran a seminar a couple of years ago on the Energy Charter Treaty. And you know, the Russians are supposed to have withdrawn in 2009 from provisional application. However, it is not quite clear whether they legally satisfied the terms of withdrawal. Of course, the Russian Foreign Ministry's legal service is not incompetent. They are incredibly competent. And that was, I suspect, to give them wiggle room so that they could rejoin or say they never left, gives them another opportunity. And I think this is part of a general Russian strategy where, you know, things are kept open and things are possible and options may be taken.
May I add something here?
Yeah.
They know very well something, that in all our countries, governments change. Mm. In theirs, the government is the same.
Yes.
And they know what might be eventually the change here and there. They might even trigger it.
Exactly. Very brief.
I have to have a very, very brief remark. One recommendation to my Bulgarian colleague. I will recommend you, as a former politician, not to fight the last war and to have a look forward. The discussion about South Stream are over. We have to discuss how to so fast, so quick to realize some north-south interconnector, because we miss this interconnector. Everybody misses this interconnector. It doesn't matter what kind of gas will flow there. Gas doesn't have flex. And we know that this bottleneck in the South Caucasian pipeline, this bottleneck in TANAP, this bottleneck in Iranish-Turkish interconnector, but we will need this gas maybe after 10, 15 years. We have to be prepared. And we discuss all the time and talking, it's better this variant, and parallelly to build up interconnector between Greece and Bulgaria. It is complementary project, but we have to realize it, to stop discussion and realize, because it's only weapon against this assertive policy of Kremlin administration.
Okay, well, let's start. Thank you very much. Let's start move to another round of questions. There's a gentleman here, and perhaps a gentleman over there. So the gentleman down here first.
Thank you very much. Tomáš Prouza, State Secretary for EU Affairs of the Czech Republic. If I may, a question to Maroš Šefčovič. When we talked historically about energy security, we talked about sources, we talked about big projects. Now the discussion is moving toward interconnections, with much more willingness in Central and Eastern Europe to talk about this, with much more push between countries like Spain and France, for example. But the question is, well, Maroš, will there be enough political will? Will there be enough capacity? And will there be enough financing to build all the projects we need to make sure that the European energy market is connected? With maybe a follow-up to Mirek Topolánek, because he's now a hands-on man for one of these very significant projects. What would you expect from the Commission to help you to build faster and more effectively?
Tomáš, this project is bankable.
And can you put the gentleman behind you and then the gentleman a few rows back?
Vincenzo Camporini from the Instituto Affari Internazionali from Rome, think tank. I did not hear, apart from one allusion by Mr. Mitov, anything about the Southern Corridor, which is being built now. Yes. So it's not something in the future. And the Azeri gas is coming to Europe somehow. I think this will be a part of the solution. I want to hear your views. Thank you.
Okay, and the gentleman right at the back. Okay, he's got two of the microphones in his general direction. Okay.
Thank you so much, Andrei Nosko. I would like to go back a little bit to the energy union again on this panel. And so the question is, you know, we are trying to do our best, and it's quite admirable. But can we actually complete the energy union and build the necessary trust, especially in terms of increasing the coordination on our energy mix without the treaty change? Thank you.
Okay, you've got a menu. You don't have to answer everything, but you have a menu of questions.
I'm sure that my colleagues will help me, but I really would like to thank Tomasz for not only the excellent question, but really excellent cooperation we have together. Czech Republic was first country I visited when we announced the energy union, and I think that how we did it there and all the organizational visit is now kind of replicated in other countries. So thank you very much for that. And his question is, of course, a very correct one, because when we want to have an internal energy market, meaning single one market for energy, what we need is, of course, regulatory understanding, removal of administrative barriers, meaning that the regulators would talk to each other, that we would use much better agency for coordination of European regulators to really set common standards and help in these cross-border disputes. But we need interconnectors. We need to remove physical obstacles. We need to make the movement of an energy physically possible. And for that, of course, we need interconnectors. And then there, I would say we are in several categories. We are in the categories, as Mirek Topolánek said, of bankable interconnectors, where it's easier. And I believe what is needed is really regulatory stability, so the investors are not afraid to invest. But then we have projects which are, I heard it once as described, that they are not fully bankable. They are something like military airport. It's not profitable, but you need it. And in this case, later on, military airport could become a normal airport. But at first, I mean, you need to overcome that, I would say, accounting approach to see that this piece of a puzzle you actually need to complete the mosaic in the region. And for that, we established this project of common interest. And there, what I have to say, and what we need to change is the fact that we have a list, we provide the financing, but very often we do not see enough of traction with these projects. It takes us too long, there is a lot of hesitation, very often there is kind of feeling on the both sides of the border, why I have to chip more than my neighbor, they need it more than I do, and so on and so forth. So what I would like to introduce is to have such a regular update of our inventory. Where we are with this project? Is it going on time? If not, what is the problem? Financial, regulatory problem? Do we need political involvement as we did with France, Portugal, and Spain on electrical interconnections? But we simply have to keep it on the radar screen. We have to keep it, you know, on the agenda, because then we lose the years, we lose the tracks that we actually allocated a lot of money, which is not used. So therefore, I think we need to be much more forceful on it economically and politically to make sure that the interconnectors are being built. And then another thing what we have to tackle is, and there the Juncker Fund could help us, that we could actually match the different sources of European financing. Because in the past it was very difficult to get financing from Connecting Europe facilities and structural funds, for example. So here, I think through revolving funds, through Juncker Investment Fund, we can actually cover some of that gap and bring that what Juncker Investment Fund is bringing, that we are ready to assure your first losses. Come with us. We believe that it's a good project, it's bankable. I see that you hesitate a little bit. We are ready to go in that project with you and with the EIB. So that should also, I hope, remove some of the concerns and make it more possible for private sector to help us to build a proper infrastructure. I really would like to thank our Italian colleague for bringing up the Southern Gas Corridor, because it's a strategic asset. And I made it very clear, it was my first trip I made as a vice president responsible for Energy Union to Baku. to make sure that we would not repeat the mistakes linked with Nabucco, where we just simply believe that this project will be built by businessmen. And it's very difficult to build strategic projects without political support, without political visibility, without creating kind of mechanism that when things are going wrong, there is somebody to help you, that you are able to remove the problems as they're coming and not piling them up and then to have big strategic problem which you cannot solve. And this is what we did. We created so-called advisory board where we put on one side businessmen, on the other side politicians who are meeting regularly, and then we created network below it. So if there is any problem, any always a problem, working permit, excise duties, and you name it, so that it's actually possible to resolve them on the ongoing basis. And we are very glad that Italy resolved the issue around Puglia. I think it's very important. It would place Italy really in the center of this Mediterranean energy hub, and we have to work like this with all the countries along the road. $45 billion has been invested in this pipeline. I believe it will bring Caspian gas to Europe before 2020, and we will have strategic assets in the area where you have Azerbaijan, where you have Turkmenistan, which is very interested to join this cooperation. And I know that it would be another very difficult discussion with Russia because of the Caspian Sea. You are in the area where you have Iran, you have Iraq. Of course, we know that they're quite important. Infrastructure build-up would have to be built, but the reserves are enormous. And as Mirek Topolánek said, we have Eastern Mediterranean. So if you have a structure in there, you can actually work with it. You can diversify it. You can scale up the project. And therefore, I think we have to really treat it as a strategic asset. And that would be definitely one of the key elements how to make sure that also energy security in Southeast Europe would be higher than it is right now, because it would be a strong possibility to link it up and to give another source of gas to Southeast Europe. And concerning the treaty change, you know, for a while I was representative in a European Convention. So we've been working together with many of my colleagues who are here from Slovak Foreign Ministry on a constitutional treaty. Then we have seen this very painful process of European referenda. Then there was very laborious process on the Lisbon Treaty, which is valid right now. And since that, I'm afraid to say that situations became even more complicated. We have constitutional law in UK. Indeed. We have the same type of legislation in Germany, meaning that before, even for the regular legislation, we are going to put on the table a legislative proposal which might imply certain transfer of competences to Brussels, you at first have to get it passed through your committees in the parliament. So I would say treaty change would be extremely, extremely difficult. We would have to take really careful consideration if we want to go down that road. And if it comes to the energy mix, I think that member states would be very reluctant to go in that way. So I think what we need to do is to combine the sovereignty rights with European common goals and work in this way, because otherwise we would spend endless years in institutional debates.
Probably should avoid that at all costs.
Just a couple of words on the South Gas Corridor. Absolutely, that's a priority. And when I'm mentioning the interconnectivity between Bulgaria and Greece, it is related to the South Gas Corridor. We need it badly. We need it very quickly, or as quickly as possible. Commissioner Šefčovič was very descriptive and clear about it. We support this view totally. The idea is, even if possible, whenever the gas quantities increase over the South Gas Corridor, even to increase the capacity of the Bulgarian-Greek interconnection, because it will serve the south-north routes and at the same time east-west through Serbia, through the interconnection between Bulgaria and Serbia. So this is something which we need to work on together with the Commission, and as well the Bulgarian connection, Bulgarian-Greek connection, will be related to the LNG terminals and any type of gas which comes from there and serves the inflow of gas in Europe in general.
Right, okay. Any Prime Minister Topolánek? Okay, well, we'll go around for another
question. Maybe we have to imagine what's the need in Port Need in Holder Balkan. Because we discuss about many rules, many sources, but in fact Bulgarian consumption or import need is about 2.4 BCM.
Three. Yeah?
Okay. The whole Balkan countries, including Moldova and Romania, has an import need about 15 BCM. It is not big volume. The whole Europe has consumption more than 400. Yeah? Mm. What's going on? What's the problem? It's only problem of routes. Mm. It's some, this TANAP and TAP way, the Southern Corridor way is good, but the volume is limited. The capacity is limited. And we have to discuss about how to solve the bottlenecks. That's all. It's a question of money. And one remark more. I didn't tell you that we won't need subsidies from European Union. Yeah? Of course, because you have to support and encourage successful projects, sustainable project and bankable project. I think is a bad way to subsidize some bad project. Yeah.
Okay. Perhaps another round of questions. There's a gentleman over there towards my left side. We have a name and affiliation, and there should be a microphone on its way.
I'm Miro Sariski from Slovak Electric Utility, and my question is, first, a very quick comment. I'm looking at the communication on the energy union. I'm seeing a lot of visions in, answering the question why we need the European Union, but the panel sort of barely touched on those visions. I mean, he's talking about interconnectors and gas, but the visions that are outlined there were not discussed today at all, almost. And the question is, again, on the subsidies. In the beginning, you're saying that the European Commission is paying, or the countries are paying, 120 billion euros per year on various subsidies, and you're trying to get rid of them. So, Commissioner Shevchevich, how are you going to do that, and when? What are the specific goals in that area?
Okay, and this gentleman over here, yes?
Thank you. I'm Choi from China Institute of International Studies. And as I understand that once there's an energy union in Europe, certainly there would be an external dimension for this union. And also, Vice President, you mentioned how about maybe more cooperation between European Union and China and India, those emerging economies, especially on clean energy. So could you give us some details and how could China and the European Union do something more? Because as we know that even now, China has already some cooperation with the member states of the European Union on energy issue. And also maybe one more question is, as I observation that now compare with previous debate within European Union about how about the energy strategy, I find that maybe more a little bit of change, especially how about this to push forward this green economy and also the efficiency of the energy use, especially related to the competitiveness of the European Union. So could you give me some ideas? How could you keep a balance between this ambitious program to have a green economy and also how could get some more efficiency, especially promote the competitiveness of the European Union. Thank you.
Thank you. So do we have a third question? Or we'll just take those two? Okay, we'll go back to the panel. Okay, I suppose the energy union communication lacks vision. Do we have a view?
No, I think what Mr. Sariski was referring to was that we very much discussed the energy security, but we a bit omitted the internal market, decarbonization, moderation of demand dimensions. So therefore, mm-hmm. as I said, we had to went for the holistic approach. And his concrete questions was touching up on subsidies. How you would like to deal with that? Of course, we had a big political debate among the commissioners, and we've been drafting the strategy and how to deal the issue of subsidies, how to make sure that price structure, particularly for electricity, is cleaner than what we have right now, where you have wholesale price and of course you have distribution costs, and then you should have some profit margin, but that's a system which is
more in the States than in Europe, because in Europe we have different kind of additional fees, which are or local taxation or kind of collection of money for subsidies for certain parts of energy. And here, probably Mr. Birol will have a clearer number, but we are subsidizing everything. We are subsidizing renewables in one country, coal in another country, nuclear in third country, biomass is fourth country. So it's kind of systemic issue, which at the same time is making price structure in every country different. So how we would deal with that? So we've been thinking about energy taxation. Was a proposal on the table, no traction in this atmosphere of today. To get unanimity behind such a proposal is almost impossible. So we said that, you know, we're not going to try it again. So what we could do? So at first we of course have to look at the issue of the state aids, how all these subsidies are used. Is it really to correct market failure on our market? Is it helping the market or is it distorting the market? Do we need to subsidize the technologies which are already mature enough to compete on its own on the market, or should we stop it? What should be the graduality of this approach? And we want to shape the system in consultation with you. So what we are going to do this summer is that we are going to present the consultative communications on redesign of the electricity market, where we will present you ideas how we want to do it. We will include the questions asking you what you think we should do, and we will open it for 6 months. After that 6 months, we are going to draft the legislation which we want to present to you next summer. And I'm absolutely aware, and in this time, as it was rightly said, I feel very much the weight on my shoulder, because I'm fully conscious that that would be kind of landmark legislation. If you get this right, I think a lot of things would go much faster. If you get this wrong, we will have a big problem in Europe. So therefore, please, all of you who are working in the energy sector, you would very much welcome your ideas and participate in this consultations. And then the question from our Chinese colleague. Actually, there is a lot going on between European Union and China in the field of energy. We would like to deepen the relationship. We would like to have high-level dialogues on these matters on a regular basis. And we are already trying to share with China some of the experience with government, good one but also bad one. We are helping China to set up the Chinese energy Chinese emissions trading system. It's our, I would say, know-how. We are also helping financially to test the pilot projects in China, and we know that China is now planning to start using ETS probably in 2017, and that would be a huge change when the market will decide the price of carbon in China. Mm-hmm. And if we will get other global players to do the same, we could see kind of emergence that in the future maybe we would have a or interlinked system of ETS or some kind of nucleus of world emissions trading system being formed. But for that, the success of China in this is absolutely crucial. And then of course, if it comes to balancing the green agenda with our competitiveness, I'm a great believer in technology. Now I'm privileged that I'm traveling around the labs and research institutes and companies in Europe. And what you see, I mean, in Western Europe, it's simply amazing. And I believe that we'll see so many technological breakthroughs in a few years. For example, I just saw the photovoltaic panels, which are transparent. So I think within a few years, I would say our windows would be just photovoltaic panels. I mean, you see a lot of technologies which are actually allowing to use the energy much more smarter than before. I mean, we will see that our cars, which I believe would be more and more electric, they would serve as a battery storage very soon. So there is a lot of things going on, and I think China will have a big advantage to be a big market and to use some of the technologies which have been already tested in Europe, so you can make even better decisions than we've made when we started with all this energy transition.
That's great. Can I add a couple of things here? First of all, about China and Europe, you may think that Europe is the region which makes the highest investment in renewables. It's completely wrong. Mm-hmm. The biggest investment in renewables is made in China. In fact, renewable investment in China last year was equal to all the renewable investment in Europe, plus United States, plus Japan. China is the champion here. Let's put this one, number one. Number two, we can see low carbon technologies or reduction of carbon and still grow. Last year, European economy increased close to 2%. European emissions declined by 5%, minus 5% decline, whereas the economy is growing. So we may well see a divorce between the economic growth and emissions if we have the right policies. It's number two. Number three, as I said in the beginning, all the discussion in about Europe, we sometimes think that Europe is an energy island, which it is not. It's not, the world doesn't consist of Europe plus Russia. There is a energy world is bigger than that, especially when it comes to climate change. 1 ton of carbon going to atmosphere from Brussels or from Washington or Detroit or Bangladesh, it has the same impact. It doesn't change anything. Therefore, let me give you one number, one put in the context. In East Asia today, and also South Asia, a lot of inefficient coal-fired power plants are built. I'm not saying coal, but inefficient, very primitive, subcritical. About 35%, there are many colleagues, utilities, they would know that 35% is extremely low. You can buy easily 45% above. If that 35% was 37%, just 2 percentage point improvement, the emission saving from this 2 percentage point is equal to the emission saving by the EU 2030 target. Just to put it in a context. And once again, 1 ton of emission go to atmosphere from New Delhi and from Brussels or from Netherlands, it's exactly the same story. Just showing that Europe is making excellent work by being the champion against fighting climate change, but we should understand that this is a global challenge. And final point, just to strengthen this. In Europe, we have a carbon price system, which is, I think, again, Europe is the first one, the champion, and we are trying to increase the carbon price so that it can have a make a sense for the markets and for the investors. Now, while we are trying to getting about $10 or so, the prices, in the emerging countries today, we have about $500 billion subsidies for fossil fuels, for coal, oil, and gas, which brings the prices artificially down, very, very cheap, which means you give an indication to the consumers, please use fossil fuels more to emit, to dirty up the atmosphere. And this 500 billion means, if you translate it, more than $100 per ton of CO2 to give an incentive to put the carbon in the atmosphere. On one hand, you have $10 to give a disincentive to use carbon, and the big part of the world, you have more than $100 per ton of CO2 to give an incentive to put carbon in the atmosphere. The reason I'm saying this, Europe should continue to be definitely with its policies, but in Paris, which we have 6 months of time, it is extremely important that there's a global agreement and energy sector is at the heart of it. Otherwise, it risks to be a failure and the countries, the sectors which are pushing the agenda may well be disadvantaged.
If you allow me just one addition to, and I'm really thankful to Mr. Birol that he brought it up, that of course the Paris is first about the climate change and about our responsibility to the future generation. But it has also very important aspect which was underlined by Mr. Birol, and this is creating more level playing field among the global markets so that the industry would have to follow much more similar rules and legislation and the costs if it comes to the decarbonization. I think it's really key for the future. As Mr. Birol said, I mean, since 1990 in Europe, our GDP grew by 45%, and at the same time, we decreased the CO2 emission by 19%. So it's possible, it's doable. We have more than a million people working in the green industry. It was only industry which was growing even in the crisis time of the 5-6 years. So there is a lot of experience which we can share, but I agree with you that the success in Paris is absolutely crucial.
That's excellent. I was wondering, are either two of the other panelists, before we go any further, take last closing comments. Does anyone have any further comments, observations on the on those issues or not? Because I think it's very interesting. I mean, the potential dynamic of the renewables. I mean, I think there was a kind of corporate oil and gas industry view, which I think still exists. You know, we can go drilling in the Arctic, and we can spend vast amounts of money doing this sort of thing because there'll be somebody who's willing to pay for that oil $100 a barrel or more. When in fact, if you look at what's happening with the renewables, I say particularly with solar advancing, with the costs falling, with the actual ability to extract more electricity from a like spectrum, the technology is getting better and better all the time. And this is incredibly transformative. And it means that we're not going to be in business as usual, that the current energy cycle is not actually going to be like other energy cycles where we go through a period of lower fossil fuel prices and then we go back to higher fossil fuel prices because the renewable revolution is really happening.
In fact, we don't need to look at the future and make statements. And so I'll just give you one number. Yeah. 2014, 50%, half of the all new power plants were renewables, 50% all others put together. Yeah. Coal, gas, oil, nuclear, 50%. Renewables around 50% globally. Mm-hmm. It's a big number. I mean, you cannot, it is wrong, it is right, it's another story, but it's a fact, market fact. 50% all the power plants came in line and 2014 were renewables.
That's great. So too. I think on this future point, I think we'll try and wrap up with perhaps 30 seconds for each of you on what is the future of European energy? So 30 seconds each on this futuristic perspective. Is it renewable?
Okay, I will start. I hope the future, energy future of European Union, European continent will be fossil because of the question of scarcity. I don't believe new climate ideology, and I hope we will respect the life cycle of production of electricity, of investment in this field, and I don't wish to Europe some rolling blackout, but it will be very educative.
Okay, perhaps Dr. Birrell, you may have a kind of broader.
No, I. First of all, I have a great belief in the Commission and Mr. Shevkovich and his team. They are really trying to put a good strategy for Europe, looking at different issues which are not always parallel to each other, such as energy security, competitors, and environmental issues. But for me, it is extremely important to understand that we are going to have major energy security problems, I believe, in the next years to come. When we look at the potential energy exporters to Europe, Middle East, North Africa, what is happening in Russia and Ukraine, therefore, the energy union is a very good strategy to secure the supply of energy in Europe, while at the same time trying to keep our environmental standards high. And therefore, I am a great supporter of energy union
in
Europe.
So, Commissioner Sekovic, I think you've got 25 seconds.
thank you very much. So, usually the question, what will be the future, so the best answer will be bright. But I know that it's not that easy. So I believe that we would deliver on all five dimensions. We will have to work very hard on, as I said, changing the mindset and convince our member states and our leaders that look at the region, look at Europe, look for common solution. Let's speak with one voice, and I believe that through that cooperation we'll have energy which would be secure, which would be safe, which would be affordable, and which would be clean. That's, I think, what our citizens want. That's what I feel the young generation is expecting from us, and we have lots of smart technologies in Europe. Let's use them and let's sell them as our strong export articles.
Excellent, and I think you've got 23 seconds.
Very quickly.
Yeah, very quickly, yes.
The energy union and the future of the energy in the European Union, we should look at it as interconnected Europe, which will be able to deliver gas and electricity from Spain to Romania, from Bulgaria to Holland on market-based prices. That's that's it.
That's great. Well, thank you very much. I'd like to all thank the panel and the usual. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Now, the usual drill, be back here for 4:45 for a discussion of America and American foreign policy. Does the Imperium still exist? Okay, thank you very much.